All right. Welcome everyone to the fourth week of our 16-week soil and nutrition conference. Here we are, June 4th, 2024. Very happy to welcome Adrian Rubi from Switzerland, who's a farmer and researcher on the topic of compost tea. He's done a bunch of work in the lab to really tease out what is and what isn't and what works and what doesn't work, and I think he's come up with some very exciting insights and conclusions on this topic that many people have heard about, but people oftentimes I think repeat what they've heard as opposed to really go down to the core science and see what the facts are. So Adrian, I welcome you to turn on your camera and take it away. I'm sorry, I don't know more about your
Yeah,
background personally. I
thank
was
you then. Yeah, I will tell something.
Okay, great.
Right.
Well, take it away.
Okay, welcome everyone to my presentation about compost tea and my farm in Switzerland called Halterhaus. I have on my farm. You can see here most of the land is of my property. I run a mixed farm with some crops and Obrac cows. It's a special variety of France, which is really good in just using grass to produce meat. I have a simple crop rotation with 2 years of grass, winter wheat, beans, and oat. Half of the farm is also not fully half of the farm is a permanent grassland. You don't see it fully on the picture, but some slopes are quite steep. As you can see in the background already, the Alps start. I also have a hazelnut orchard. They are inoculated with truffles. And I hope in the future to also find truffles in the soil as a really value product of the benefits of soil mycorrhiza fungi. But I think I still have to wait 3 years more. Also, with the hazelnuts, it takes about 6, 7 years until I can harvest the first hazelnuts. Recently, I just grafted all the trees in the field with the European hazelnut varieties. I also have a lot of land which is for biodiversity. In Switzerland, we get paid quite well for it if we follow the rules of the government. And I also, as you can see in the picture, I have some high trunk trees for cherries, plums, apples, and so on. I work around 60% of my on the farm, and an average Swiss farm only has 50 acres of land. We are all mostly family run. I try to work on my farm on the regenerative principles, mostly in the German-speaking part. It was very pioneered by Dietmar Näser, which also gonna have later on a presentation about his principles about the regenerative agriculture, which is very interesting. He also wrote the book, which I highly recommend to read. For me on the farm, also the cow is very important. But as everyone know, it's the how and not the cow to run everything according to regenerative practices. The cow has a very high status in Switzerland. We have them mostly everywhere on the fields, and we also go to summer holidays to the Alps. Here you can see some impressions how it can go. It's not so easy sometimes to walk up with a herd of cows, 4 or 5 hours, very steep trails. It's a special experience, but it's fun as long as the cow walks nicely. The view is the payment for it. It's just stunning. The cows stay about 3 months on those high grassland slopes, which create a very beautiful biodiversity, as you can see in the picture. Wouldn't there be cows, everything would be forest. It wouldn't be so nice for the tourists, the whole landscape. And it's just a passion of the Swiss farmers to take care of this tradition. They also still produce in a very simple way on the fire the cheese, or have just the heifers to not get too fat on those very not very diverse fields. My other passion is the compost tea. I started about 6 years ago the company Edapro, which is mainly focusing on producing those compost tea machines. The Richard started already 12 years ago during my studies as environmental engineer. It was great. The university gave us a key to the lab. So me and my friends spent many nights in the lab under the microscope, propagating the microorganisms, do simple most probable number tests, so on and so on. It was a great opportunity to really get a deep insight into the topic and check it on a scientific level, how the compost tea works and how the parameters involve the quality of the compost tea. We also do, as a company, consulting. We do a lot of leaf sap analysis by the farmers, also see what is the effect of the compost tea, what can we achieve with compost tea, but which nutrients are missing to really boost photosynthesis. We think it's a key parameter in producing healthy food and in promoting soil life, as also building humus content to really have a good photosynthesis. We work there as well with Nova Crop Control and help the farmers with all the paperwork to send the samples there. For me, there are many inspiring people out there already since a long time. They wrote about the soil life, especially in the French and German speaking part. Raoul Heinrich France and Annie France Harach. They wrote a book in 1913. She made beautiful pictures about all the soil life, and they already went with the microscope to look at the terra preta and already then said how important the diversity of soil life is. And this book is like you read a book today about soil, it has all those aspects inside. With the compost tea, we were really blessed to find suddenly a bit of chaotic website of Tim Wilson, which had a lot of inputs about how to build a compost tea brewer with a lot of microscoping videos. And of course, we got a lot of inspiration by Elaine Ingham. Probably most of you know the Soil Food Web School, which is just brilliant how simple and good she explains everything. Then also in Europe, we have some very experienced soil scientists, especially for composting. Angelika Lübke-Hildebrandt, her father used to work together with Pfeiffer on those round filter chromatographies. We also see later in the presentation. Yeah, and I love to listen to John Kempf podcasts all the time when I'm in the car, and I'm glad there are more coming because I spend to visit customers all the time, sometime in the car or in the tractor, and it's just amazing to have those podcasts watching all those very exciting topics about the soil health. So our principle of making compost tea, everyone knows it's mainly water. That's also the great thing. We don't need to ship a lot of containers full with mainly water around to sell a biostimulant. The farmers can produce it by itself. I think it's also very eco-friendly to just make it on the farm and not have this huge logistic with those liquid biostimulants when you buy it in a can. So we add 3% of compost and 0.3% of nutrients. Our compost tea brewers produce a vortex. I think it's quite important for the structure of the water. Later, some pictures on it. We always try to be above 6 milligram per liter dissolved oxygen. And we usually brew it for 24 hours to 48 hours by 20 degrees. If it's colder, just brew it a bit longer. The microbiology is slower to propagate. And you're still gonna have the similar results like you use a heating system. But we also saw often in spring, if you take the cold compost from outside, it maybe has 10 degrees. If you start the brew with cold compost, it just takes 4 or 5 hours longer until this compost is waking up. So I try to warm the compost in the spring, take it to the house, just to speed up the compost tea brewing process. And after 24 hours, you have the finished compost tea. We also call it ACT, as actively aerated compost tea or aerated compost tea. And we also did all the research on aerated compost tea and not on those non-aerated compost tea. You also find a lot of research from Egypt or India, where they just soak compost in a pot for 2-3 days without aeration. But I think for having the control of pathogens like E. coli or Enterococcus, it's very important to aerate that they are not propagating. Here are some recipes we have in Europe. One is from Matt Powers to just compare how this more basic thing many people know from Europe, from America or from YouTube. The other companies are all from Europe. Some are working with really low amounts of compost, adding for this a bit more food to still have a good propagation. Many use molasses. We from Edapro, we don't want to use molasses because we also had problems with propagating pathogens. So our main ingredient is the alfalfa powder, algae powder, some rock dust and humic acids. We see very good results with those. By the powders, it's just very important that it's very fine grounded. But I think the recipe, what you add, is not the most important. The most important is really the compost and the good design of the compost tea brewer to not have some parts which are not oxidated well. So the really important thing for me is that it's easy to clean. I saw many farmers, they use compost tea, they don't have time to clean, and on some parts you see the dirt getting more and more, and in those parts you just can have bad microbiology, which you don't want to have. So I like to work with those cone tanks, and we really focus more and more and build them in stainless steel. It's also in Switzerland, we just love quality. That's our main thing in everything we produce. We want to have the best. Yes, so we started to produce those very luxury stainless steel brewers, which have a great benefit because we also can ferment in them because they are airtight containers. So it's like this, we have a other use for those expensive machines. It's not only for making compost tea, you also can produce your ferments. In Europe, a lot of compost tea brewers also have a heating system. There we saw at the beginning some mistakes. They just put too much heat from the outside, over 60 degrees. So we saw that you even sterilized a bit the microbiology during brewing, which was not so nice. So just if you use heating, control the heater as well, not go over 60 degrees. And also, if you have a vortex brewer, it's very important to have those good upscaling to make bigger outlets if the tank is bigger and so on, and control the air. We all know the brewers from Growing Solution in America. I think they are some of the first commercial sellers of compost tea brewers. If you have those sieve baskets, just add air into it. We tested some little brewing system of Growing Solutions, which didn't have those air into those sieves. And we really saw the biofilm formation around those sieves, and the microbiology just didn't go into the water and resulted in very low amount of microbiology in the water. You also can have those simple cone tanks where you just blow the air from the ground in it. I think it's the most simple way. Easy to clean everywhere, good oxidated. But the only thing, of course, is you don't have a vortex. You don't really structure your water. We tested this with those beautiful microscopy images. So to just that you know what it is, those images are not from composting, they are just from water. So the upper three pictures are with those air just from the bottom into the cone that you don't have a vortex. We bubbled it 24 hours, the water. Then you take a little needle with a very little drop of this water onto the microscoping slide and let it dry. When it's dried, you use the dark field in the microscope and you see those beautiful images, which really fascinated me. You see those blue parts, which is probably the easy water, which is Gerald Pollack writing in his books about it. And you also see how the water gets structured. Sadly, in the those are 400 magnification. In the 1000 magnification, you really saw this crystallization of those minerals, how they were dried on the microscoping slide. And we see those three images on the bottom with the vortex brewer. It really, when you do those image tests, it's what you want to see. Do not have those strict lines, which suddenly something is not there, or those black parts, which really show there is a problem with the water. This person, which did the pictures for me, she is also focusing on 5G, the effect on water, like mobile phones or wireless or anything, which really has an impact on the structure of the water. I'm really not an expert on it. There are many people which dive much more deep into this topic. And Glenn Ryan also had one time a presentation here on this topic. It's very interesting. And in Europe, also about 90 years ago, there was Victor Schauberger, which had some very amazing tools and techniques of how the water has to be vortexed to get this power of the water. And also what we saw in Europe, there are two producers of vortex brewer. One is us, one is in Austria. And since then, compost started to spread to the farms, also with the help of Dietmar Näser. For him, it's also compost is an important part of the regenerative agriculture to vitalize the plants. So it's very hard to measure these things. It's also, we did tests on plants. Of course, we haven't seen the difference, but all in all, we also saw sometimes in the tests that just the structured water already had an impact on the plant. Of course, we also look for measurements which are easier to explain, and this is, of course, the dissolved oxygen during the brewing cycles. So you see the first 6, 8 hours is just extraction, not much propagation. Then it starts, it goes up and down, and after 24 hours, we get to a similar point. So I think that's the reason why we brew the compost tea 24 hours. It's also easier for the planning on the farm. We also saw that the nutrients really off the compost and which we add, they slowly go into the microorganisms, they use them up. You see slowly more and more protozoas popping up. So it gives a bit of stability of protozoas and propagating bacteria. We always take both into account, simple measurements with numbers, but also imagery methods. It was not always easy on the university with the professors to talk about image microscoping and the round field chromatography and so on and on. But I still think if you take both into account, really get a good picture about everything. So with microscoping in the compost tea or in the compost, I'm not fully focused on this fungal bacteria ratio. It has different reasons. I saw a big change sometimes in a compost pile. You can have a very fungal active compost. You sieve it, you store it, you pack it, you sell it, and the hyphae are disappearing. you put this compost tea onto agar plates, and a lot of trichoderma pops up. Even I don't see them anymore under the microscope. So I think if a compost had wood, it's break down the wood, there are fungi, and they not fully disappear. Still, diversity is important for me. Also, the propagation during the compost tea brewing process is important. I really want to see numbers going up to 10 high 10, up to more than a billion microorganisms per milliliter of water, which is important for me. Also, I check the clay humus formation process, especially in the soil. I want to see big aggregates. I want to see organized soil structure. And I really love those testate amoebas, which is also the biodynamic horn preparation is full of those testate amoebas. So I think they have something important. But still, you can have a very diverse compost, which doesn't grow anything on it. So here in the middle picture, we see the cress test. You just take those cress seeds, put them in a container with the soil, wet it, and close the lid. And this is very important when you have the lid closed. It's very sensitive. If the compost is not finished, you still have some gases producing, which is slowing down the germination or even completely stops the germination of the seeds. So a very simple test. You can do it nearly everywhere. You don't need expensive equipment, and it tells you so much. It really tells you if you have plant growth promoting bacteria. You can see the roots here. You see if the compost is finished. And this in combination, you check if you have diversity, you check if you have a good cress test. And with this, we see all the time success with our compost tea brewer to know we have a good compost. Other method we did a lot in the past, right now not so much because of time reasons, is the round filter chromatography of Ehrenfried Pfeiffer. He also was in contact with Rudolf Steiner and those Lübke family, which is still doing compost courses here in Europe and also in America. So over many generations, they collected a lot of data and knowledge in the way of making compost in a very good quality. So this round field chromatography also can use for food, for compost, for biofertilizers, and you can read a lot out of it. But also there, my colleague was much more diving into this topic to read those filter chromatographies. But I still think for measuring soil quality, measuring compost quality in a holistic sense, it's one of the best methods out there. So a bit more how it looks in the practice. This is a picture of my farm with our brewer. After 24 hours, we put a pump inside and suck it out. Because we have compost and everything inside, not in a sieve, we have to kind of let it sit first to have most of the slurry in the on the bottom. It goes then directly into the tank sprayer, is sieved in the boom sprayer. It is sieved again and then sprayed immediately. I spray usually with a dilution of 1:1 onto the leaves up to 1.4. But mainly 1:1 with about 150 liters or 100 liters per hectare, not acres. It's hectare. I haven't changed here the things. Also, I avoid high EC, but I add also nutrients. I check with the leaf sap analysis which nutrients are missing, especially the trace elements, and then I just make specific plants. Mostly in the spring, it's boron and magnesium. When it gets dry, I change to zinc and manganese, and I all the time measure the EC. Do not go over 3.5, just to. You have to know the microorganisms already struggle with an EC above 1.5. If you add more and more, salt. It's just not good for them. We also always check on the roots. Important for us is this rhizosheet heat formation. That's the nice compersion all the time. Just walk to the neighboring fields, dig out the winter weeds, and 10 meters next to it is my field. After 3 years of regenerative practices, I already achieved quite a difference. I must say, this year I haven't seen any rhizoheat formation. I think it also has a bit of an impact. We had a lot of rain, the soil cannot breathe, so the microorganisms are not as active as I wish them to be. So this picture I didn't achieve in each year, but that's how I want to see the many fine roots, a lot of earth stuck onto the root. And I think this is a main property of the compost tea. We spray it onto the leaf, we vitalize the plant, and the plant gets with the compost tea a better connection to the soil. So the roots are not just white, naked things trying to search for water in the ground. They are fully connected with the microbiology. That's why we use the compost tea in the regenerative practices in Europe to vitalize the plants and indirectly inoculate the soil with diverse microbiology. But I think the effect is much more spraying it onto the leaf, having the kind of a stimulating effect onto the plant. And with those root exudates, we build up soil humus, and there we promote a healthy biology. And on very lower stage, also the microbiology, which is coming from the compost. So here are some trials we did on a rehabilitation of alpine vegetation. Switzerland is a skiing resort, so it takes quite a long time after the skiing until the snow is gone. What comes out is bare gray soil, and it has to be greened as fast as possible because in spring we have those heavy rains and already the first thunderstorms. So they have a lot of problem on those ski slopes after that. The soil gets washed away and gives trenches into it, which is after that not so good for skiing. So it has to be green fast, it has to get fast as possible roots. So we tested the compost tea, and we really saw this boost in the root biomass compared to the whole mass of the plant. Where you see with compost tea, we have much higher amount of roots compared to the upper part of the plant. And also a bit an effect on the above ground biomass of the plant. The only struggle is to spray the compost tea, but now with the drones, it got easier to really spread out the microbiology. Some bit more promotional tests of our system. We tested our food compared to molasses. We also saw here we have a much higher growth rate in the root biomass. This alfalfa powder is really great because you really have those root promoting growing compounds in the alfalfa, gives strong roots. And we even had the better results with the own compost tea than with trichoderma, which should do the same to boost plant growth, but it's not all the time like this. So I think the most important aspect of the compost tea is really those metabolites of the microorganisms, also the humic acids out of the compost. Also, all the enzymes and amino acids and so on, which already are in the compost, and then also are produced during the propagation process of the compost tea brewing. Because we see a huge propagation, we see those protozoa coming, eating the bacteria, and all those excretes are very, very good leaf biostimulant. We also did tests with inoculating soil, bare soil or potting soil, and later on, maybe a week to sowing or and planting in the potting plots. But we didn't saw good results. We mostly see very good results if there is a growing plant, a seed germinating, or really leaves and roots are already there, and then spray the compost tea. Compost tea is also full of endophytes. I really love all these things of James White, of rhizophyte cycle. It gives a whole new picture about how compost tea can work or is working. And also about the research of Olivier Husso about the redox potential. It also was a new insight for me that it also could be from this. So I also started to measure the redox potential of our compost tea, which is not as high as Oliver Husso's compost tea is using. I think the vortex brewers are not as aerated like the fine bubble brewers of growing solution, for example. So you see here many different systems, many different ways of producing compost tea can give a bit of different output of the product. So research is endless, but it really helps to at least understand a bit better. Then the compost tea, of course, full of many plant growth promoting microorganisms, and of course in the long term you all the time inoculate the soil with beneficial anaerobic microorganisms. I put this down in purpose because for me the most important part is really those active compounds of the microorganisms, those metabolites. I think it's the core mechanism of compost tea. The biology is for me second. But of course, also very important, as you can see later. So even our research institution of Switzerland made a trial with compost tea. They wanted to test it against apple scab. It didn't work, but what they saw with 12 foliar application of compost tea, they had significantly amount more of the earthworms. So also here you spray compost tea onto the leaf, but you see the effects in the soil. I really think the plant pumped more exudates into the soil, which in turn promote the earthworms that they had more food. And slightly you can see the soil structure was getting a bit better, but it's also hard to estimate. Here some tests we did with the leaf sap analysis. We see here the sugar content. The first field was the control, second field was compost tea, then again a control, and then again compost tea. In most of the cases when we spray the compost tea, sugar content goes up in the leaf sap analysis. Not in all the cases. It's really sometimes if the leaf sap analysis you see some results in some fields. So I would say in 70% of the cases we have an increase of the sugar content. We also do a lot of brixing with the refractometers. Sometimes there are effects, sometimes not. Even the sugar is not going up. Sometimes we see the effect in the silicon, or we see the effect in more root growth. There are not consistent results in the field, but most of the time somewhere an effect happens. I also think you see there the property of the compost tea. It's very diverse, it can have diverse effects, so you never know what else is the problems in the soil. Compost tea of course not solve all the problems when the soil is compacted, when there are important nutrient missing, some nutrients too much, so on. That's also probably the reason why each field trial gives new surprises. We really have consistent results with the silicon content, that this is going up, and we don't have much silicon in the compost tea. Of course, we add some rock dust, but I also really think it's the biology which then helps to get the silicon mobilized into the plant. Sometimes you have effects on potassium, sometimes also on phosphorus. It really depends how is the level in the soil. Of course, if you have already enough potassium, you not really see an increase with the compost tea. Often we have the effect that the nitrogen better gets bind into the complete complex nitrogen the versions, so nitrate levels go down into the full compost tea, into the full the compost tea helps to bind in the nitrogen into the total nitrogen. So I think it's very important to also work with those leaf sap analyzers when you go out and spray the compost tea. This is the most expensive work of the whole concept of compost tea, to bring it out to the fields, to spray it. The production is not expensive, not so much time consuming. So then it's sad if you miss out, if you lack in boron or in zinc or any other trace minerals, to not add them. And there, the biology of the compost tea really helps that those nutrients go much better into the leaves. This is also a big trial we did. We have here on the left the KOA is the negative control with water, then water with mycorrhiza added. It's on grasses, those trial, and we sprayed 3 days after sowing the first application of compost tea, and then every 15 days we sprayed again compost tea, and after 55 days we measured the colonization of the mycorrhiza onto the root, and we wanted to see what is better, compost tea with mycorrhiza or mycorrhiza. So the other control was with sterilized compost tea, where we see a bit of negative impact onto the mycorrhiza formation. I really think because we sterilized the compost tea, we added some nutrients. If you add nutrients to those mycorrhiza tests, often the mycorrhiza formation on the root is lower. It's often also seen if a soil has a very high phosphorus content, you barely have any mycorrhiza formation. So in the middle, the brown ones is the treatment with the compost tea and the treatment compost tea and mycorrhiza, and we really see that only compost tea already boosts mycorrhiza formation, and we barely have any mycorrhiza spores in the compost because they are disappearing after 1 year of compost process. We also only use old compost, which is 9 months to a year old. And even if we add the mycorrhiza spores, we didn't saw more colonization on the roots. If we add actomycetes, we collect them in a forest, we saw a little better colonization of the mycorrhiza. So I really think if you want to have a good mycorrhiza fungi on the roots, it's not only adding the spores, it's really adding a diverse range of microbiology, which also helps the plants to get the symbiosis with the mycorrhiza fungi. And we really see the negative control opposite the positive control with treatment with plant protection agents, fungicides. We really had a bad effect on the colonization of mycorrhiza fungi. In the opposite, there are a few studies showing if you sterilize the compost tea, you don't have less effect on the biomass production or on the root biomass. Sometimes the effect was with compost tea even lower than with the sterilized compost tea. We also did some trials on that. Sadly, I don't have the data in nice plots, but we see about 20 to 30% less of effect if you sterilize the compost tea, but you still have about 70% of the effect. So more of the efficiency of the compost tea from the nutrients and the biology helps with other things like with the mycorrhiza fungi formation and so on. But yeah, there you see sometimes effects they talk a bit against each other. But it's really both. It's biology and those metabolites in the composting. Also here with rhizoheat formation, we saw a little effect on the compost tea in this trial, or how many knöllchen, those are the rhizobias by the faba beans, that they were promoted with the compost tea. Another big trial was done by a student last year. We wanted to find out if the pH has an influence on the efficiency of the compost tea, because when you brew compost tea, the pH goes up. I all the time thought it's because of the compost and the propagation of the microorganisms. Good, we had a very ambitious student, so she also tested just the water aerated, and so if you aerate water, the pH goes from 7.2 up to 8.1. So we think we blew out the carbon acids with the aeration process and the pH in the water goes up. So it's not really the compost tea which gives the high pH, it's adding air to the water which raises the pH. So often when we sprayed in all our trials you saw before, we sprayed compost tea mixed with water with about a pH of 8. And if you read all those, how to design the perfect foiler spray application and everything, they lower the pH to 6, 6.5. So this was our goal. And we saw here in radish, the B is the compost tea with CE is the pH lower agent. So KT is the compost tea, CE is just the pH lower end agent. It was a citric acid and the control. So the only significant difference to the control we had with the compost tea, which had a pH of about 6.3. It also proves what we saw in the fields. We often saw that compost tea didn't have such a good impact on all the brassicas like canola. We often sprayed their ferments like lactoacid bacteria to get a biostimulant effect. So it proves a bit that it depends maybe on the plant family if you have to lower the pH or not. In the spinach, there was no difference if we lowered the pH in the compost tea. And it's also what we also observed with many trials we did with grasses and wheat. So there we see less effect, but it's never bad to lower the pH if you also add the micronutrients that they better enter the plant. So probably now everyone is confused. I have to start explain. I hope it works. So here on the top is compost tea, or better said, a compost extract, because we didn't add the nutrients, but we aerate the compost 24 hours. WRM is a warm compost, and the microbial analysis for bacteria was five times repeated. KEX is a thermophilic compost which was turned many times to really have those nice round filter chromatographies. And the bigger those bubbles, the more are inside of those bacterias. Then the orange one, both composts, feed it 24 hours with molasses. So we saw a huge increase during the composty brewing process of the Acinetobacters. And also, for example, here, Yocanella and Raudelitella. I'm not so good in the Latin sometimes, I'm sorry. So those two microorganisms are potential pathogens. It's very interesting because if you look up here, the DNA tests didn't show them here, but now they show up. Magic. I don't think they were in the molasses. Also could be molasses is not sterile. I think sometimes those microbiological tests, if you have very low amount of bacterias, they are not measured. They are still there, and suddenly, boom, you have a lot, and the tests are measuring them. But we saw that with other compost, you already have less, like with this thermophilic compost. So in the thermophilic compost, of course, you have a bit better cleaning out of pathogens than in a warm vermicompost. So the blue part was then with our food mixture, which is the alfalfa, algae, humic acid, rock dust powder, only based on powder without molasses. So here we see we have less of those Yocanella and the other, and with the thermophilic compost, it's barely anything visible. And the green part is just the compost, just put some compost in, shake a little, and then performed the DNA analysis of the microorganisms. So what we saw here, it was for me a bit of disappointment at the beginning. I all the time thought during those 24 hours we take good compost, we propagate all those good aspects out of the compost and the diversity. And of course, this test doesn't include protozoas, it doesn't include fungi, but it includes, I think, the main part of the compost, the bacterias. So what you propagate is mainly those Acinetobacters. So it doesn't make sense what else can propagate in those same conditions during those 24 hours. Of course, by far not each bacteria profits of those conditions. It's mainly the Acinetobacter, which is a main bacteria in breaking down organic matter. Still, if you check the literature about Acinetobacters, you find a lot of research that they are phosphor mobilizing, plant growth promoting, bacterias, even in some plant growth promoting agents, those bacterias are inside. We also propagate some of the bacillus, not so much as you see here in the compost already. We have big bubbles. Some of the pseudomonas, a bit more with the molasses. Also, many of those names, if you check them for soil analysis or for plant growth promoting activities, you don't find much information. So you really see soil microbiology is still a big black box. It's only measured down to the genus. It's not really you still have many different Acinetobacter varieties with in the soil. So all in all, it looks nice. You get a better insight of what is living inside, but in the end it doesn't tell you much about the effect of composting, how composting works, and so all those different microorganisms. I found in these names at least eight different plant growth promoting bacterias. So I think it's quite good if you can produce something like this on farm. So, in conclusion, for me, what I learned on my farm or with the whole scene of regenerative agriculture, for example, 2 years ago, Nestle, it's one of the biggest food corporations, medias, that they have their very ambitious plan to be to source 60 or 70% of the food in the future from regenerative farms. And you often read regenerative farming is crop rotation, cover crops, minimal tillage, implementation of animals. And so you can name yourself regenerative. When I look back on the history of my farm and or many farms in Switzerland, we all have crop rotations. One reason is we have to have crop rotation, the government says, otherwise we don't get the subsidies. But in also many farmers know crop rotation helps to keep diseases out, to have a good production each year. And all organic farms have to implement grasslands in the crop rotation to for the soil recovery. And also we have a lot of mixed farms with cows, as many farms have a bit steep land. And yeah, it's also something, the cow is highly subsidized in Switzerland, that we send them to the Alps to holiday, that they can graze something. It helps in the other hand for tourism. So we all the time had grazing pouches on our fields. We are all family run farms with not so heavy machinery. But still, when I measured my soil organic content, that was by 2.5%. Of course, for some, it's wow, at least something. We are only by 1.5. But what I want to say is, even we have a good history of many parts of regenerative agriculture, it doesn't mean you have a good soil or nutrient dense food. I really think you have to deeply understand each part of those methods of regenerative agriculture, of those principles. So what was wrong on my farm that I don't have better soil? So we also had a piggery. I stopped with the pigs because for me it's just wrong to import soybeans from Europe or even from Brazil to feed our pigs and call it then Swiss quality meat. So I stopped this nonsense. My father had those pigs, so a lot of food came from out of the farm. So we had a lot of nutrients with very bad quality. You smelled it. Of course, what we also did, it's also a bit a thing of the small farmers. A little tractor can pull a plow, but not other machines. So mostly the grassland was plowed. And we also used some nitrogen fertilizers and sometimes fungicides in the wheat production. It definitely also killed microbiology. And I think one of the worst parts was really 5 times a year we were bringing out the manure from the cows and the pigs and the houses onto the field. And each time you had to close the windows, you couldn't hang the clothes outside, they started to smell. And it's a bit the thing what we are in Switzerland, also in the Netherlands, the farmers are considered as, yeah, it's just the smelly people. They have the animals, they don't smell well. And this is something which is completely wrong. If an animal is healthy, if the environment is healthy, if they get good food, and if you take care with the right microbiology, all this smell can disappear, also in the manure. And this is another big part of what we do with our compost tea brewers, that we can propagate those EM, those lacto acid bacteria. Here is a little trial what we see in the manure. If you add just a little bit of those lacto acid bacteria into the manure, you really see the microbiology kicks in, starts to propagate, lowers the pH, you have less ammonia gases going out. The nutrients get bind into the microbiology. We also add rock dusts or biochar or leonardites and so on. And we also the slurry, the manure gets more liquid, which also helps that the manure much better infiltrates into the soil. And for this, we measure pH, redox, and EC, but here in the diagram is pH and redox and calculate the RH value. So a good manure is red, you have close to zero, slightly minus redox potential, and you are slightly in the sour part with the pH, and then you really get a good quality of the manure. And mostly Schweinegülle is the pig manure. I haven't translated it. And the cattle manure is black, is already better, but not really good. So that's the goal in our work, and we really achieve this with those ferments. So it looks like this. It's the compost tea brewer. You see the air blower. We use the air blower just at the beginning to mix everything in the tank. And we also all the time add the herbs of the fields. And you see here on my field, I have this very beautiful strip of biodiversity, which I rotate as well. We also get subsidies for it. It's not, I mean, I like to do it, but it's nice if it's paid as well. I think it's also a part of the farmers to take care of the biodiversity, but it also has to be paid in some ways because it's, of course, farmers destroy biodiversity a lot, but it's not only the farmers, it's also the consumer buying those products of the farmers destroying the biodiversity. So in the end, it's good if the government acts and also supports the farmers to do something for biodiversity. Anyway, I shouldn't get too much political. We soon have some votings about it. We can vote in Switzerland, but everything also about the use of pesticides, but people still want them, sadly. Anyway, you collect those herbs. You also can collect some weeds or anything. Just they have to be healthy. And also add them to the ferments to just extract some good nutrients into the ferments and also add the biology again and also something of the farm. So this brewing system has a heater. I let it sit for a week and propagate my lactoacid bacteria by myself. I can use it also for Flächenrotte, which Dietmar Näser and Erwin gonna explain later as well in presentations. We also use them to boost if we add the green manure to the soil and also add those ferments to the manure, which really has a great impact on it. Perfect. I'm in the end. So thank you everyone for listening. If you are more interested in my work, you can follow me on Facebook, on EdaPro, or on LinkedIn. And I have here these two beautiful images I one time found of Kate. She did the Soil Food Web School and is also really into the soil biology. And my goal is that everyone, all my microorganisms, have a chilled life in the soil and can relax and also have a pleasant life and not just all the time struggle of what we do wrong as farmers. So thanks.
Thank you very much, Adrian. Do you want to? Yeah, there we go. Beautiful. All right. Erwin is here. We had a bunch of panelists last week, but only one this week. And Erwin has worked with you a bunch, and integrating your techniques and your brewers and insights. And he's part of why we're gonna have Dietmar speak as well. I've got a bunch of technical questions, but do you have anything you'd like to say, Erwin, just from your experience as a farmer and integrating some of these techniques into your operation and what you've seen?
Yeah, I can, because I can introduce a little bit how I got to know Adrian, because we were also taking the course of Dietmar Näser and got interested in compost tea and started along with brewing in IBC totes and other plastic containers. And then my father said, I discovered something on the internet and it is like the top class best of the world composty brewer. It's all stainless steel, and it's all guided with computers and so on. And it's from Switzerland, so this is the best, but it's very expensive. It's out of our league. And then after getting along with these plastic containers for 2 more years and getting tired of the cleaning of it, because microbiology will easily leave a biofilm and it's very hard to clean, we were still looking at this Adapro machine. And then I thought, okay, I have a somewhat bigger farm as most of the Swiss farmers, so I want a twice as big tank, and I want two of them. So I contacted Adrian, and I asked him if he could help me design one by his specifications. So, you know, what kind of pump and what kind of valves do you need? And it's all very specific. And he said, yeah, of course, I'll just help you. And he also came to visit to check the result. And he did it just out of friendliness, as a friend. And I was so amazed by that. And now we have this stainless steel composter brewer designed by Adrian. And it's working very good. It produces a very good result in the compost tea. And also the cleaning is like 1 or 2 minutes instead of 3 hours. So we are very pleased with that. And one of the things I learned the most from Adrian, which is very surprising to me, is that the compost tea, when you sterilize it, you still have 80% of the working. And that's what he tested on the effects of plants. And they still have 80% in comparison to the non-sterilized compost tea. And we often had discussions about that and why this is the case. And I don't know if you can go into that a little bit more, Adrian. Why is it the case that sterilized compost tea, so all the organisms are dead, is still valuable to plant growth?
Yeah, I think during the propagation process of the microorganisms, so when we add the compost and everything and count the microorganisms, we have maybe per milliliter 1 million of microorganisms, and it really goes up to 10, high 10, 11, so over a billion of microorganisms per milliliter. So you have this propagation, and when bacteria propagate, you have different metabolites, vitamins, enzymes, amino acids, and so on. And if you kill them, you even have more of those active compounds. But also those active compounds, they can enter the leaf directly, so the plant can absorb directly amino acids, vitamins, and so on. And with this, you get a great response of the plant. It's the same like for humans. You feel a bit, oh, my stomach, oh, I struggle with power. You have the right tea and you feel better. So I think it's the same for the plant. And also in those herbal teas we use for humans, it's not about biology, it's about those active compounds. So that's why also in our food source for the compost tea, we have some special herbs, which we know it helps. It's kind of this similar principle. But of course, the microbiology is important to produce those active compounds. So it's not something we can leave behind, but it's, in my opinion, not the most important part to get a high fungi activity or to have a bacterial fungi ratio. And if you don't achieve it, it's not a good compost tea. I think it's a bit a wrong way on looking on this topic. You want to see the effect on the plants. That's what matters.
Do we need to check for fungi anyways, or is it totally not a goal?
Diversity is a goal. We want to see diversity in the soil. So also we know most of the soil lost a bit of fungi. So I think it's an important aspect as well. But also if you have more root exudates and more microorganisms in the soil, I think fungi which still exist in the soil are coming automatically as well. I think it's a good side effect of the compost tea if you also have some diversity, some fungi spores, and so on.
So, I mean, I think I'm reading between the lines a bit, but you're saying things that are somewhat what's the word? sacrilegious for those who
Yes.
who are part of the compost tea soil food web world. Is that what's happening right here? Was that the comment that just transpired, that there's some things that are taught to people about what they need to have as far as the ratios in the tea, and you're saying not the case? Is that what I just heard?
Yeah, I don't want to disappoint everyone. I think it's a good measurement thing, but what I'm a bit wanted to show in my presentation is there are many little parts you can measure, and each one tells you a bit something different. So I think it's important if you start to work with biology or regenerative agriculture, not walk like this through the world, because the world is open. There is no line between a fungi and a bacteria and a plant. There are all the time organisms. They are a bit of everything. So, yeah.
Well, so I think part of why I wanted to have you on here was to speak to the, I think there's actually a number of people in attendance who have been in that, taking the soil food web, you know, courses and learned about compost tea and things like that. And you've done a bunch of research. You've been looking at these things. You know, if you had to, you know, broadly comment about what you understand is shared in the, that sort of soil food web perspective, and what would you add to it? What would you speak to the general, like, insights that are conveyed?
I think in the soil food web school, you really learn what is the basic of a good compost. Like, you have to turn it, you have to aerate it, you have to get the right mixture about carbon and nitrogen, all the quality assessment with the good structure and so on. I mean, in the school, all my professors couldn't tell me what I see under the microscope, and it was Alan Ingham or Tim Wilson or all those people which helped me to get it, to see what are those microorganisms, to open the eyes. I really loved it. I just think, yeah, it's not only the biology, it's also the nutrients. It's not really bringing biology to the soil. It's working together with the plant and the roots. It's this interaction between a living plant and the soil, which building up soil humus content, and not really the microbiology, which is decomposing organic matter. Most of the organic matter is from the root exudates. So I think this will look a bit different at it, that we look at it as a plant stimulant and not a soil inoculant. I think this is one key aspect. We look a bit different at it. Yeah.
So, I mean, whether you're calling it a inoculant or a biostimulant, you're agreeing that the positive effects are there. Are there other things about the making of the teas that you would speak to, or what people are taught, that you think from your literature, you know, could be added to?
Yeah, I think I mentioned a bit in Europe, we were late with compost tea. In America, I think it already was, the hype was going a bit down, and suddenly in Europe, all the farmers started to use compost tea. But what I saw was the difference is many started with those vortex brewers, which I haven't seen much at the rest of the world, that they use vortex brewers. And we have a guy, he's building 10,000 liter kind of vortex brewers. And even there, sometimes some things with low amount of compost or not really all the time having the control of having enough air inside, the farmers had those really good stimulation effect on the plants. So I think this aspect of the structured water is important and shouldn't be left out when you make the compost tea. But it's really also something which goes into this direction of bio-nutrient dense food, or in the biodynamic way, where you look at the whole picture of the performance of a plant, not just the yield.
Yeah, and I think one other thing that you've been adding along with the vortexing, which I think is, I would agree, a very good idea, and Yeah, you don't even need to have any compost tea to have benefits from spraying if you vortex the water. But you've also been strategically adding minerals, which I think is something that's not necessarily advocated for in the compost tea world, right? I mean, you've from your research, you're seeing that that's a beneficial piece. Or speak to the. I don't want to tell you what you think. Tell me what you think about why you're adding different minerals and what results you're seeing as on top of the tea, which is not actually a
Yeah.
necessarily inoculant. Yeah.
So I started to sell those compost tea brewers. And of course, the first farmers after 2 years called me, like in apple orchards or in vineyards, mostly in perennial cultures. There is no effect. So I drove to them and checked and tell them, yeah, there is no effect. I'm sorry, I don't know. Yeah, I did everything what I could do. So I went out to the internet and checked. I need a measurement to see what I do wrong. So I got into these John Kempf podcasts and all those leaf sap analyzes. After the 10th podcast of John Kempf, I realized that this lab is in the Netherlands. It's not so far away. So I started with those leaf sap analyzes and just saw in those orchards, oh yeah, there is no boron. There is no calcium available. There is just a huge lack of zinc. And as soon as we added those missing micronutrients, we saw the effect. We really saw those rhizohids formation, better shoot growth and everything. And it's not a lot. It's half a liter of boron per hectare, and you already have those effects. But if it's not there, I don't think the biology mobilize it, because boron especially is washed out in our regions. Yeah, what to do?
So, if I may say, this is a not the normal compost tea storyline. I would say it's much more of the acres. I call it the acres storyline, the sort of the integration of biodynamics and permaculture and agroecology and organic and conventional ag and all that kind of stuff. So I really, yeah, and the weed teas as well, you're adding, which I think is another beautiful piece of the ferments. So yeah. Well, I've got a number of specific questions, but I think I wanted to make sure we got out that sort of, the yes and framing about compost tea. But just before I move on to the specific questions, are there things that are taught about how to make compost tea that you think are not correct, or are there, places where people fail regularly? Or, I mean, you mentioned molasses, you didn't speak to it too directly. What timing, for people who are out there doing this, what are some key lessons you think they should know, or perspectives they maybe have not heard yet?
Yeah, for me, the crash test is important, because often people use compost which is not old enough. So usually after 10, 11 months, the compost is really ripe, that you don't have any more wrong gases coming out of the compost with decomposing processes. So if you take the crash seed and close the jar, you see if it grows, then it's good for using compost tea. So this is one key aspect for me to make a good compost tea. I think aeration and molasses and stuff is important to really have pathogens under control. So you all the time have to keep it in mind. If I use it for vegetables which go into raw consumption, you have to have it under control. If people suddenly are infected with E. coli, it's not helping your business. So if you use it for trees or row crops, it's definitely less important to have the pathogens under control. So that there is a bit the key aspect of the molasses.
What you're saying is very, very gentle. What you're saying is, if you use molasses, you can have pathogens in your tea. I think that's
Yes.
what you said, but you didn't
Yeah,
quite say it directly. Trying to
it's a it
tease out the
depends, of
commentary here.
course. Yeah. It really depends on the amount of molasses. I think if you use less than 0.1% water volume, it's okay. If you we did our test with 0.3%, and we already had the propagation of molasses, and there is also other scientific literature proving the aspect of the molasses, it feeds pathogens. Yeah.
And the reason people are putting in molasses is because they want to get balanced fungal bacterial ratios. Is that the reason why they think they're doing it?
I
Why are
think
they being told to do that?
it's a cheap, complex mineral nutrient. So you get a lot of trace elements. It's easy available. It really boosts microbiology. You see the activity under the microscope. Yeah, I think those are the aspects, and somehow it sticks around in the internet that they use molasses for compost tea brewing. Yeah,
which causes pathogens to be in your compost tea. to put a clear point on it, I think sometimes it seems like the way you're framing things is so gentle that the clear takeaway is not evident unless you really listen between your words. I've got another question about how the compost is made. And, you know, there's the Lubkes, and there's turning, and there's, you know, regular turning, and then there's the sort of the static pile, and then there's the, you know, Johnson-Su.
Mm-hmm.
And there's, you know, worm castings. Talk to us about that, and what is your experience with Johnson-Su type compost versus actively turned versus, you know, the high woody, you know, untouched and worm castings. How would you, you know, suggest one works better or worse? What have you seen about composting?
And also, can you explain the crash test? Because I think you went over that too fast for people to understand.
Sorry, my internet connection is a bit bad, but I think it works.
Yeah, yeah, we got you back. Yep.
With those different composts.
Yeah, different types of making compost and what's most appropriate. Worm castings versus turned versus static, for starters.
I think for making compost tea for the leaf application, it's better to be a bit in those bacteria dominated compost with the worm composts and those very much turned compost, like the Lübke compost, where you turn maybe in the first day 3 times and then just all the time measure the CO2 content and then turn that it's not going too high. If you turn the compost a lot, of course the fungi never has the time to sporulate, so you have lower activity of fungal hyphae and the spores. I think it's important to really have the carbon to nitrogen ratio on a good level, because we want to have some available ammonium and nitrate out of the compost for the propagation in the compost tea. So if you have a too woody compost, you don't have the nitrogen, so you should add more nutrients But we do mostly is really to take the fungi active compost, like from Johnson-Su, to add a little of it and mix it with a worm compost, and we just mix different composts to just buffer maybe the bad qualities or something to get the microbiology. And we focus also a bit with the woody compost or Johnson-Su composts to use them as seed inoculates, and everything which is more active with bacteria and protozoas to use as a leaf stimulant.
Have you worked with worm castings at all as a you know, a compost to be putting through the brewer?
Yes.
Have you seen anything that affects?
Also, the microbial analysis I show was one a vermicast and the other was a thermophilic compost. And right now what we sell is a mixture, 50-50, half-half of vermicast compost and thermophilic compost. What we saw is with the vermicast compost, you mostly achieve a much more steady quality. And the thermophilic compost, they are just depends on how much rain you had, if they are outdoor, what temperature, and so on. They are much harder to get all the time the same quality of the compost.
Yeah.
But they bring a bit other biology.
So a mix, and I think you were talking about going out and getting some forest soil as well. So a mix of these different ingredients generally is what you're suggesting is appropriate to be having.
I don't think there is this prime compost which beats all the other compost, what sometimes people looking for, that wow, this compost has so much better performance than other. I think there is a lot of bad compost out there,
Yeah.
You should look out to not use a bad compost and not too much focusing on it to get the wonder compost, or how to call it.
Yeah. And I mean, and so sort of to counter this sort of way of doing things, because I personally, as a farmer, find it quite a lot of work to go through the process of making these teas and vortexing them and going out and spraying them on a regular basis. You know, the Johnson Sue sort of framework is suggesting that that 2 or 3 pounds of that compost spread out on an acre of land is a very powerful inoculant that can cause dramatic increases in organic matter level and you know, mycelial activity and stuff like that. So what do you say to people who say this is all sounds very nice, and you know, some people like to mess around with complex machinery, but is there nature doesn't do it quite this, have quite such a level of effort involved? Are there simpler ways? Or
yeah, definitely. What we also all the time see in leaf sap analysis, if you have an undersowing or a plant mixture, you get better values in the leaf sap analysis, you get better root growth, and you really think it builds up organic matter. So if you can avoid monocultures, you maybe need less compost tea. But we as farmers in cropping, we just have those monocultures or not fully polycultures. We really try to implement this stuff, but we still, especially, so it helps to buffer a bit these negative effects we do on the soil. And if you have a maybe there is not fully necessary. But in the other hand, and in this test we did with spinach and radish, even with the teachers and professors, we made a blind eating test, and everyone chose the compost tea version to be the best spinach. So I still think you can get this little bit of extra out of it. It's not fully necessary to use it, but it can help. Yeah. And also in Europe, organic agriculture and biodynamic agriculture is still on the rise. So we have those farmers that take over a farm like me, and it's damaged with fungicides, with the practice they did. Not in purpose, they just didn't know better. And I think it just fastens up the process of regenerating the soil. And if you have the possibility to use it, if you have the time, if you have the money, I think it's good to use self-made compost tea than to go to the big agriculture companies and buy something out of the can, which should help boosting the biology. Yeah.
Wonderful. Cool. Well, Erwin, do you have any other comments or questions?
Yeah, I think it is well worth the effort, because you can put a lot of your own good intentions in making the compost tea, because it is almost 100% homemade, and you can do such good with it. So yes, it's an effort, but yes, you don't have to pay a bill to anyone. And that gives very good satisfaction.
Huh? And the putting of your effort in can be almost a prayer,
exactly,
a process of blessing.
Yeah. Yeah,
which is perhaps not what Adrian has spoken to, but I think is also part of the vortexing process in biodynamics. Is as I understand it, a big part of it is not just getting that those spirals to occur, but also to have positive intentions being conveyed.
Yeah. For me, it is, as a biodynamic farmer. Yeah. But Adrian, can you elaborate on the crash test? Because I don't know if people got that, but that is something really important that you can do very easily yourself to check for bad compost.
Yeah, like I said, if you really close the jar, no gases can go out. And during decomposing of compost and organic matter, you sometimes have ammonium or some sulfate compounds which lower the root growth. So sometimes those plants are fully yellow and not, they germinate but not really grow. Or you see it on the roots, they don't form those very thin root hairs or side roots. So you have a lot of things you can look at. Is the plant growing well or not? And there you see, is does my compost has plant growth promoting microorganisms? And if it's fully ripe, I say, like the compost is fully mature. And this is very easy to test. It competes all the chemistry tests.
And I think another test you had on that same slide, as I recollect, was chromatography.
Yes.
Which I think perhaps some people here are not familiar with. And, you know, again, from the biodynamic tradition, which is has a lot of wisdom, you can see the sort of the structure of the the graphic, you know, the mm-hmm. basically it's like a fractal, you know, picture that shows up. It's a beautiful sort of a mandala almost. The more coherent it is, the richer, the better, the higher the quality of the compost, but also as a tool that can be used for testing food, et cetera. I'm not sure if you want to speak at all more to that, or even sort of pull up that graphic if you can and show us, you know, maybe just to spend a minute on that, because I think that's another very interesting test that people can do to look for overall system function, as opposed to going to labs and sending in samples and getting mm-hmm. numbers of DNA and RNA and minerals and sap tests. These are, for those of us, you know, a lot of farmers don't have the money to be able to send samples off to a lab, and I think it would be helpful to know some of these very simple, you can do them yourself tests.
So this round filter chromatography is basically you take a compost or a soil, you ground it very fine, you use some basic chemicals to kind of dissolve what is in the earth, and you let it run slowly over a filter paper, and there in the end you can see also if all the organic matter is built into humus complexes, and also if the compost, for example, had enough air. You can see if there is a white part in the middle, it shows there was all the time enough aeration. And then it really gets these beautiful structures, like this crystallization, like when like a snowflake, or when yeah. water crystallized. There are these different images methods. So if you have there those very nice growing out, you see there is a fungi activity. You also can see if you have a diverse range of different humic acids in the different color fragments. So you can read out chemical parts, but also physical parts and also biological parts. So you have everything combined in one test. But you have to learn it with other people how to read it, which is a bit the struggle in it. But all in all, I think also in India, in the biodynamic community, they conduct a lot of those tests, and it's can really be a big part of how I get a good quality compost or a good quality soil.
Yeah, I think having practical hands-on things you can do, maybe it takes a little bit of time to learn, but then you don't need labs and Western science framework. We can yeah. use sort of ways of looking at nature. It's always very valuable to be emphasizing. great. Well, I see more than 30 questions here. So I'm not sure if you've had a chance to look at the questions, or I can start reading them out to you. But
I have them open now as well.
Yeah. okay, let me see here. Hannah says, thank you for the great presentation. I do have one question. What is in two sentences the main target of applying compost tea? Very, like, what's the essence of why? I think you covered it broadly, but
yeah, for me, really the essence of compost tea is that the roots connect with the soil. I want to see rhizoid formation on my roots, and I want to see nice root formation with many fine little roots going on. So with compost tea, I always achieve better root growth.
Yeah, and that's foundational to soil health and plant health. Yeah.
Yes, exactly.
Claire has a question here. brain exploding with questions. Thanks. How does Adrian have compost tea with different proportions of nutrients? He mentioned at the start adding a compost tea with calcium and magnesium. at early growth stages and didn't mention what nutrients are for different stages. How is this different ratios of nutrients achieved? How are teas two made with different pHs? So how do you get the nutrients in? I think you talked about conductivity. You didn't talk about the exact, you know, is it borax or sodium borate or whatever? But this is, again, a piece for the broader compost tea community is to sort of look at the integration of these key elements. How yes. do you actually do it? How do you integrate them into the tea?
So the nutrients I just add in the end to the tank mix when they're already diluted with water, and to the end, then the first the water, then the nutrients, then the compost tea. And the nutrients I mostly add according to the leaf step analysis or to my experience, what is missing. And which kind of nutrients in the end you have to use, what is available. I really like if the nutrients are already chelated. It's more dangerous for the microorganisms than a chelated boron. And same with zinc, same with manganese.
And when you're, so when you say you're adding nutrients, like manganese sulfate, zinc sulfate, borax quantities, you know, how many ounces per hectare? Just can you give some ballparks for people to understand sort of what they're, what we're talking about as far as scale?
It's very hard. I mean, usually it's around 1 kilo of a nutrients per hectare. And, but it really depends. What is the product? How much diluted is? How? Yeah, it's very hard to say. Use so much of this any nutrient. It also depends how much deficiency you have. Yeah.
And it, but it's not 1 gram and it's not 10 kilograms. It's 1 kilogram per hectare, or which is 1 pound per acre, is a ballpark of the quantity mm-hmm. that you're putting out. You're saying, yeah.
Yes.
And I think a lot of people perhaps have heard about buying foliar sprays, and they're engaging not only in the work of doing the plant sap analysis, but they're also buying products that can be used for foliar application. Effectively, you're making that yourself, buying the raw ingredients and making the tea. So I think that's another piece of the puzzle perhaps to speak to. The second half of Claire's mm-hmm. question was about how do you shift the pH in the water. I think you said citric acid, but
yes, citric acid, yeah.
Wonderful. okay. Claire asks, does he use specific plants for particular nutrients, example, comfrey or horsetail, or is it a mix of plants that varies depending on where and when the plants are harvested? So this is for the ferment. This is not for the tea, which I don't think he went into in full depth. Do you want to talk about that?
The herbs are for the ferments, and in general, you can use all kind of herbs you find on the farm as long as they are not full of fungi or anything. The leaves have to be healthy. But there it's just to get something of your farm into the tea.
And the ferment is something that is not making tea, right? This is a separate process than making.
That's a separate part. That's a separate process. I had it in the end of my presentation to also show a bit what I see is very important with adding ferments to the manure, and it's also those production of the ferments is one important part of the regenerative agriculture we do in Europe, what you're also going to hear later more about. Yeah.
Okay, so we'll hear more about it with Dietmar and Erwin. We don't need to talk more about it now. I think part of Claire's question is, are you using specific plants to address specific mineral deficiencies? You know, nettle is known to be something of a boron bioaccumulator.
They're not. We just look for diversity. I start to use like with undersowing in wheat or in other crops. Like there are now some good analyses that clover brings a lot of magnesium, and sunflower brings a lot of boron. Phacelia helps to mobilize phosphorus. So we start to work with this. I have right now a wheat field which has around 3 kilos of seeds of phacelia inside, and I see really good effect on the phosphorus. So we work more there in the combination of the plant and then target the nutrients, but not extracting them or something. There it doesn't really work so well.
I think there's a you know, some people talk, or I think in some circles there's a sort of a resistance to adding minerals to your soil and the thought that nature can do this and we could harvest everything we need from our land. Mm-hmm. And you're saying it's actually really helpful to bring in some boron and add it. and maybe you can, maybe nettle has some, but you'd have to use a lot of nettle to get that much boron. So
yeah, exactly. And it's sometimes very hard, like in an apple or in a vineyard to grow sunflower, it's sometimes just not possible.
Yeah. Okay. Chris asks, the water you use to make a tea with, what is the origin of the water? I think this is a really important question I was wanting to touch on, but I hadn't gotten to yet.
Yes.
You care about the pH, you care about the mineral levels, mm-hmm. you care about, what do you pay attention to? And
I like to use the most rainwater.
This ready. Uh-huh. Mm-hmm.
Ken, we can hear you.
Get this.
Ken,
just a few minutes. I can write this order up for him. Oh, can I go a little bit? Cut.
Shauna, okay, thank you, Shauna. Yes.
Perfect.
Brilliant.
Yeah, so I like to use rainwater because it's all the time the same. It doesn't bring a lot of calcium or anything which binds them to the nutrients or raises the pH or the EC even more. So rainwater is the best. Otherwise, if you don't have a big rainwater tank, or it's just run out, we use the water of the tap of the spring and just vortex it a bit before, structurize it, and we also see the calcium falling out in the vortex, and it gives them a better quality. So yeah.
And for those who are living perhaps in a area where they have issues with lots of metals like calcium, you're saying that can be vortexed out. How mm-hmm. about fluorine and chlorine and
the chlorine, I think, yeah, then maybe it's good if you use the rainwater or let the water run through some biochar to just get this stuff out. Like I said, rainwater would be the best. If you don't have the option, try to bring out those minerals. It's,
yeah,
it's better not having them in the brew. Yeah. But it also, if you have just a little, like my water on the farm I have, it has a pH of 7.5. It has a lot of calcium. I see the effects. I not all the time vortex it perfectly. Sometimes it has to go and do it better here.
Okay. Sue says, Cress is not readily available in Kenya. And the Crest test is such a fabulous nugget of information. What other seeds could we use? Brassica seeds like kale or maize seeds? I think you want things that are germinating rapidly. It's a general thought, no?
Yeah, and the Crest is very sensitive. I think tomato is also a bit sensitive, or spinach is sensitive. But the good thing is, I mean, there is already some videos and things you find on YouTube about cress seeds, and just use all the time the same seeds. So your brain learns the images you get out of it. If you change with the seeds all the time, it's just harder to learn those effects of the compost onto those things. Yeah. And cress is very fast. So
something that's fast, something that's fairly sensitive.
Yeah.
Yeah, you don't want things that are feisty and will grow anywhere at any point in time. I find arugula seeds sometimes, at least when you buy them, to not be of particularly great vigor and vitality and sensitive. Mm-hmm. And they germinate usually within, 36 to 48 hours.
Mm-hmm.
Perhaps they're a little weaker than kale seed. Nicholas asks about what form or how you chelate the minerals that you want to add to make them not, burn or add the raise the conductivity too much. Do you make the chelate minerals yourself, or do you buy them chelated for your foliars?
Yeah, for my farm, I buy them mostly already chelated because I don't need huge amounts, so it's too much work. basically, you can take citric acid, fulvic acid, and some algae extract, and just vortex it or bubble it in a brewer for 3-4 hours, and you can chelate your nutrients. But it's not I'm not an expert in it to make your own chelates.
Yep. I know what can be done. I know there are techniques out there, but it is a job like a lot of others.
Yeah, yeah, I just measured all the chelates by, and so each one has a different EC pH. So there is some more behind. So yeah, I think with the research you find online, you really can go into this field and produce your own. But it's and it is possible with the fulvic acids and everything. But yeah.
So the fulvic acids and the humic acids will help buffer that high EC. I see a couple of questions here asking what EC is, mm-hmm. electrical conductivity. Yep. Do you want to try to explain that? Just
the
very high level of knowledge here, and these jumping back and forth to redox to rhizophagy to.
Yeah, so the EC is actually the electrical conductivity, which easily measures how many dissolved salts are in the water. And the microbiology, of course, has this ideal EC. If it goes too high, they struggle to propagate or even die, because then you have this osmosis effect that it sucks out the water out of the cell. This is one part. And also, if you go too high, you can, if you add too many nutrients to the leaf surface, you can start burn your leaves. So you also have to be careful for this. And if you constantly go out and spray, you're more and more adding nutrients, it also can have a side effect onto the plant growth. And the nice thing is those EC meters, you get them cheap, they work well, they don't have to be calibrated. It's basically two things. The electricity goes from one point to the other and gives you a number. So very simple to measure.
Yeah,
electrical conductivity. In the other hand, if you have a fully sterile water, there is no electricity flowing through the water.
Right. So you want it to be within a certain range. And you said, I think 1.4, I can't remember if it's a millisiemen.
Yeah, the maximum 3.5. The compost tea by us ends in about 1.2. So in this range from 1.2 to 3.5, we can add nutrients, yeah.
And the more chelated they are and the more humic acid you have in the water, the lower the EC will go. I mean, the less it'll rise, basically. You can buffer that.
You can buffer that, yeah.
Precisely. The really simple way to buffer the salts I found is simply take some liquid humates or some humic, you know, acid powder, and you stick it in a bucket and with some water, and then you dump in the fine particle, copper sulfate or zinc sulfate or solubor, and the trace element will dissolve in the water because it's a salt, but then it'll buffer to the strong humic compound there and not, you know, have that EC rising or burning effect. That's a low tech way to go mm-hmm. about it.
Yes, this definitely works. Yeah.
Yeah. Claire asks, can Adrian explain more about metabolites being more important than biology? Sorry, I didn't fully understand the reasons for this. I think I asked about that, but I do think it bears repeating. One of your key conclusions from all this research is that it's not about the number of bacteria or fungi in the tea, it's about what they've produced. Walk us through this again. I think for those who are in the soil food web, her ID says Claire Soil mm-hmm. Food Web Student. So
of course, Erwin and me, we are crop farmers, so we don't can produce as much compost tea to inoculate soil proper. So what we do is we spray the compost tea with fine film with a boom sprayer onto the leaves, and this is our main goal with the compost tea. It's a biostimulant we add to the leaves. And in this practice, we just saw we have a lot of the effects coming from the metabolites of the microorganisms. That's why we also did those tests and just sterilize, autoclave the compost tea and kill all the microbiology, and we still had a good effect. And I think this is a key aspect, that those metabolites are important, and it's something we just don't see under the microscope. That's why I put this on very, on the top of the effects I think we see out of the composting. In the other hand, of course, if you have a little garden and you produce a compost tea and you walk with the can and add just huge amounts of compost tea, maybe there it has different effects. But just in all the tests we did where we inoculate the soil and then planted something into it, we just didn't saw good effects. And if we used a tenth of it and sprayed it on the leaves, we had the effect. So, yeah.
So this is a question from Annabelle. Why compost tea over solid compost applied directly to the fields? Is it a matter of logistics, i.e. you need to make less compost for compost tea and yes, easy to apply, more financially viable? Do you think there's a difference for soil health in applying compost tea compared to solid compost?
Of course, if you have a huge amount of high quality compost, you can apply it. For me, when I apply compost to the garden beds or to the croplands, I look at it as a fertilizer. I bring some nitrogen, I bring a lot of phosphorus, I bring potassium, so it's really fertilizing my soil. If I spray compost tea, it's a biostimulant. It just helps the plants to go over stress situations. Like this year, we had a good growth of the crops, and then we had snow again and 0 degrees, and the crops started to get those yellow leaf tips, so they were fully stressed. So as soon as I was able to drive, I sprayed compost tea that they recover fast. And if I would spread compost in this situation, I would have to wait a few weeks until this compost is slowly incorporated into the soil. And then, of course, it brings also biology, it brings nutrients, but I not really have this stimulation effect. And it's also more efficient. I can use a low amount of compost where I focus on producing high quality and use them for a biostimulant. And with my manure, I make ferments, and with all the big other parts of organic matter I have from the straw beds of the cows and everything, I make bokashi, because it's for me much easier to handle. I take it out of the barn, I put it on a place, I put a lot of ferments on it, press it a bit on, cover it with a plastic, and 3-4 months later, have a perfectly bokashi. And I don't need to turn it all the time. So, but I look at it as a fertilizer then, and not a plant stimulant. So this is a bit the different aspect.
Yeah. I think in many cases, you know, the access to sufficient organic matter to make compost in sufficient quantity to cover many acres is not there. There's a lot of parts of the world where farming, you know, we just don't have enough of that raw organic material to make a lot of compost with. So yeah, strategic for sure.
And I also see sometimes in greenhouses side effects of adding all the time the compost. Suddenly you have too much salts inside, that the phosphorus level goes up and up and up and starts to block the sink and so on. It's compost is great to recover the soil, but with everything there is a limit.
Moderation in all things, some minerals, yes. Some microbes, some compost, some cover crops, some tillage even perhaps, yeah. But it's not compost is all we need, or compost tea is all we need, or exactly. Minerals is all we need. Yeah, I think that's hopefully a common theme across, but it's great to reinforce. Let me see. Yassim asks, what do you use for vortexing the water? I think you had a couple of slides where you showed us the machine. Made, but that, I mean, that whole thing that happens, and you referenced Schauberger as well, as of course as Glenn and
Pollock, yeah,
who we've had on this conference in the past. Can you talk a little bit about vortexing and you know, even maybe some really low tech? I think you had one example of a plastic one with a cone that just had one tube coming into it, but
yeah. So the basic is you have this cone tank. And the pipe is coming out of the cone, and then on this bottom pipe we blow in the air, and then you have this air pushing up the water, and in the cone then there is just a 90 degree angle, and the water is coming out and starts to move the whole water So after 4 or 5 minutes, slowly you see the vortex coming, opening up and going nicely down. And it's just the perfect rhythm movement. It's all the time together. Yeah, but it's very simple. It's also called this airlift brewer. You just have to go somewhere in with the air. Some go take a pipe with the air and put it down to this pipe where it goes up, and it just starts to move everything. Yeah, if you check out Tim Wilson, Microbes Organic, there are some simple designs in English and everything how to build it.
You did give us a bunch of citations and links in this presentation. I hope people take advantage of that. I was not having any time to go into it all. I recently just watched a couple of films about biographies of Schauberger. And I think even if you just go to the Wikipedia and look up Victor Schauberger, you'll find a couple links to videos there. A really brilliant man who understood a lot. And, you know, if you want to get down the rabbit hole of vortexing and all that kind of thing, it's a really exciting topic. Victor Schauberger is certainly worth a dive into. Brilliant. Okay. Emma says, I'm in a part of Kenya where the soils are heavily degraded and we rely on irrigation for farming. Unfortunately, the water is very high in sodium and carbonates. Are there any compost teas that can mitigate this and or other things? Do you have any comments on that first, or I could touch on it?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, biology helps to buffer, and the advantage if you make a compost tea versus a compost is with the compost you add even more salts, and with the compost tea you don't add so much salt but a lot of biology which helps. You also bring some humic and fulvic acids if they are in your region not available, but otherwise, like Dan already digged in before, fulvics and humics really help to absorb those, and there you have maybe some more insight, because I'm not experienced in salty soils. All our salts are washed away. We have so much water all the time.
On the top of the mountains.
Yeah.
Yeah, but I mean, but saline soils in hot, arid areas are a serious issue, especially. And then if you have water that has those aspects, I think leonardite is the sort of the name of the ore that is basically brown coal. It's soft coal. We call it humates. You can oftentimes buy, you know, bags of humates, which is basically just a not fully pressed coal. It's early in its process of development. And if you can get a 50-pound bag of humates of whatever size they are, they're fairly easy to crush. So you can just take them, spread them on a you know, cement pad and get something flat and heavy and just stomp them a few times, and you get this powder that's humic. You know, it's just a very finely powdered humate, and that has a remarkably high binding capacity. And so if you can add some of those finely powdered, you know, humates, or you can buy humic acid if you have the money to buy or access to buy, but you don't need to buy that product, you really can buffer a lot of the things that stand in water. Yeah, and then also I think we had a question from Chris about bicarbonates in well water. Biochar would be a very similar thing, similar function. So at the end of a fire, if you've got some those little, they're black, but you can easily pound, you know, grind them up in your fingertips. That char, same effect. Take some of that and grind it up and put it in the water and put them and that'll help to buffer. Tie up those sodium and carbonates you're talking about. It won't remove them, it'll just make them not available. So I've had a lot of success doing that. And you can use some kind of a fertilizer injector effectively to do that, just add a small quantity to the water. All right. Robert asks, can you clarify the effect on pH? I think it was the effect on pH.
All the time saw in the fields that on canola, we didn't saw effects of compost tea. So I started to wonder, like I said, when you make compost tea, the pH goes to 8. And in theory, to use a leaf stimulant with a pH of 8 is way too high. So we tested on two different crops, and like we saw in the brassicas, there was an effect on the pH lower and on the spinach not. So I think it's a bit plant specific if you have to lower the pH or not, but it's never wrong to lower the pH to make sure the efficiency of also added nutrients just goes better into the leaf. And most of the leaves in the sap, the pH is around 5.5 to 6.5. It depends a bit on the plant. So if you go with it with a spray with a pH of 8 and the plant then sucks it in and has to lower the pH to 6.5, it uses a bit energy of itself. And if you already have the correct pH for the leaf, it's of course better.
Beautiful. All right, I think we've only got 5 minutes left. Do you want to check and just take a minute and scan through the questions? I keep going through them and they keep coming in. But
okay,
if there's anything there that you feel like you haven't addressed or would like to speak to in the last few minutes,
yeah,
we have.
I just have here on the top one, why flax seeds in the mix. So with the fine grounded flax seeds, we bring vitamin B12, which is very important for the microbiology, especially by the legumes to fix nitrogen, that this process is working well. It's an idea behind it. It's not fully tested if in the end it works better, to be honest. But we produce organic flax oil in Switzerland. It's a very healthy additive for our mueslis in the morning. And so we get this very cheap and ground it up. And yeah, I think it's a valuable nutrient. Would you mind repeating how you check the minerals and trace elements? So I also send compost tea samples to Nova Crop Control with the mother measurement. So I also see what trace elements I have in the compost tea, and I send the leaves to Nova Crop Control to check. But of course, if you don't have this lab, I don't know how hard it is maybe from Africa to send those samples. It's very hard from Switzerland sometimes because we are also not in the European Union. But anyways, there are also some hand meters. You can, the Horiba hand meters, you can measure potassium, calcium, and some other elements. They are maybe available in some countries. It's also...
But what you're doing, what you're actually doing with the leaf is you're sending, 12 leaves off of 12 plants in a bag to a lab that is then basically sucking the sap out of those leaves and assessing what nutrients are in that sap, right? That's technically how you're determining what you have low levels of or in the plant as it's growing. So that's a very expensive and highly technical process. I will say, we've got John Kempf coming in next month to speak at this conference. And, I think I wrote it up in the newsletter talking about this, but he's coming up with handheld meters that can be used in the field to test, to effectively cause us to not need to do plant sap analysis at all. I'm not quite sure what the price points are and how many are being manufactured and when they're going to be released and things like that. But to be able to be in a dynamic where you can get the results of a plant sap test without having to send samples off at $150 a piece, is going to be a massive breakthrough. And as I understand it, he's also working with, developing some in-field microbiome assessments that are going to be able to give you a really sophisticated assessment of the levels and families of the different communities in your soil in real time. Again, I don't know about the timeline, I don't know about the cost, but being able to assess these things in real time is going to be quite empowering for those who are understand.
And otherwise, like for everyone which is working with small crops, small farms, just make polycultures. It really helps. Also with the incorporation of different levels or syntropic agriculture in the warmer climates, it also brings you to this what we are doing on bigger scale fields.
So syntropic agriculture is a word maybe not everyone has heard of. Do you want to speak just about, I mean, from Brazil? I think he's actually German, the guy.
Yeah, he's Swiss, yeah.
So he's Swiss even, okay.
Yeah. the syntropic agriculture, I think it's really a system for the tropics where you are all the time keeping your land in succession. So you have those pioneer plants and the next level of plants coming, and you just... everything is growing fast, so you're constantly chopping everything to the ground. So the soil constantly has food and digesting it. So you kind of boost the whole system of all the time having new vegetative growth. That's the way I understand it. I'm not an expert because, with the winter have complete opposite thing. But I just have a friend, she has a farm in Brazil, and she was very motivated going to Brazil, make a compost. And after 2 weeks, it was disappeared. The ants took it away. So she had to change the way of making agriculture. Yeah, it's not everywhere the right thing to do compost or, yeah.
Yeah. Ernst Gotch?
Ernst Gotch, yes.
Ernst Gotch, yeah.
You also find very nice YouTube videos of him. I think for the people of Kenya, it's maybe a very interesting thing to dig in.
Yeah. Beautiful. Well, we've come to the end of our 2 hours. Thank you. Thank you very much. This has been a very engaging and detailed and specific and practical. We've got a lot of questions came in today and not enough time to answer them all, but... thank you very much, and I hope everyone had a good time. We'll see you next week.
Yeah, thank you for having me here.
Yeah.
Goodbye.